All right, the last section in chapter 4, 4.9 talks about the rank of a matrix. So this is the last section for real vector spaces. So let's look at what this definition tells us. If we have A is an m by n matrix, okay, so we have the rows and the columns. The rows of A, if we consider them as vectors in R sub n, okay, so notice there are n entries here. So if we look at the row vectors, the rows rather, they're like vectors in R sub n, all right? So these vectors will span a subspace of R sub n, and that subspace is what we call the row space of A, okay? Similarly, if you look at the columns of A will have m entries, right? So they will be considered now as vectors in R upper m, all right? If you look at these vectors, they will span a subspace of R upper M, and we call that subspace the column space of A. Okay? So that's our first definition for this. Next, we have the theorem that says that if A and B are row or column equivalent, then the row or column space of A is exactly the same as the row or column space of B. Okay? So if we look at the proof of this, if you know that A is equivalent to B, then really that means to say that what? You get B from A, right? B is obtained from A by applying what? A finite number of elementary row operations, right? Well, it's, sorry, I forgot. I put row here. Row equivalent to B. So B is obtained from A by applying a finite number of elementary row operations. So when you do that, really what happens is that the rows of B are linear combinations of the rows of A, right? Because yeah, imagine your row operations, you say replace this by twice row 1 plus whatever row 2, right? So that's what's happening. So if the rows of B are linear combinations of the rows of A, that means to say the row space of B must be contained in the row space of A. Right? Okay? Now, similarly, you can reverse it. You can talk of B being row equivalent to A, apply the inverse row operations, and then you can conclude that the row space of A is contained in the row space of B, if we reverse the story, right? Okay, find the inverse of those row operations, the elementary matrices that correspond to those. And these two will give you the equality that you need, okay? So the next example will show us how to, actually this theorem is very useful in finding a basis for given a spanning set, okay? I know we did that before in 4.6, but I'll explain in the next example how it works, okay? This is another way of finding a basis for a spanning set in, let's say, Rm or Rn, okay? And that's the next example that I'm going to show. Let's see how the theorem applies to this example. I have this matrix A, okay, which is 4 by 5, all right? And let's look at the rows as vectors in, these are what? These are vectors in R sub 5, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So we want to find a basis for the subspace of, I think I copied this wrong, R5, right? Spanned by V1, V2, V3, V4, all right? So let's find a basis, not for the entire R5, but just for the subspace of R5. So let's see. So what I did here was to pivot, as usual, right? And I ended up with this matrix in my notes. So we have 1, 0, 0, 0, 1, negative 6, 0, 0, negative 1, 2, 0, 0, 2, negative 3, 0, 0, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, okay? So this is the matrix A in the theorem. And it's row equivalent to a matrix B, okay? The basis for the subspace of R5 spanned by these four vectors is really what you call the row space of A, right? And we were able to show that A is equivalent to this matrix B, which has two non-zero rows. Okay, you don't have to make that a one, that's enough, right? This has these two non-zero rows. So according to the theorem, the subspace spanned by these, of course, we have to consider the non-zero rows, right? Is exactly the same as the subspace spanned by this, all right? So we ended up with these two. This will span the subspace. Obviously, these two are linearly independent, right? So therefore, this is a basis for the row space of B, correct? Okay? So this, I mean, what I'm saying is this vectors 1, 1, negative 1, 2, 0, 0, negative 6, 2, negative 3, 1, this will form a basis, this set will form a basis for B, the row space of B, right? But because of the theorem, this will also, what? Form a basis for the row space of A, okay? So that's what you have, is the basis for this, okay? For the subspace generated by V1, V2, V3, V4. So what I was saying earlier is notice that this is very different from the way we did it in 4.6. In 4.6, we did something else, right? And actually, let's show you. In 4.6, if you go back to the video on how to find a basis given a spanning set, the basis that we found was actually in the original spanning set, okay? So we have V1, V2, V3, V4. When we did this technique in 4.6, we got one of these vectors. I mean, the basis contained these vectors, okay? If you apply the theorem that we just proved, okay, it gives you a basis. This works as well, but notice that none of these vectors, I should say, are these, okay? So actually, let's recall how we did it in 4.6, and just so you know what I'm talking about, maybe you guys don't even know what 4.6 is. Okay, so how did we do it back then? Okay, that's the next thing. Okay, the way we did it in 4.6 was if we had these vectors in R sub 5, right, V1, V2, V3, V4, what we did was we made these vectors go as columns of a matrix, okay? Well, since we call this matrix A, this is the transpose of A, okay? If you remember, that's how we did it. We put the vectors going like this, okay? And we did it, augmented it with a zero vector, okay? All right, and we solved this the associated system. And it's in my notes, okay? I won't show you the work. I ended up with this, okay? And if you remember in 4.6, we look for the leading ones, right? Okay, or in my case, I just say look for the columns of the identity matrix that you can find. And it looks like I found these two, correct? Okay, so back in 4.6, we said that because these two spots have the leading ones, okay, that means to say that V1, V2 is your basis that you want, right, from the spanning set, okay, of the subspace. So that means that the answers are found in your original, the given vectors that you have. I don't know what I'm saying. Okay, you know what I mean, right? Okay, so whereas today in the other theorem where we're going using the row space of an equivalent matrix, okay, we got different answers, okay, they're not necessarily in the spanning set, but as we said in the theorem, it's the same thing, right, because the rows of B are really linear combinations of the rows of A, so really the two vectors that you got using that theorem are linear combinations of these vectors that we have here, okay, so that works out, all right?